Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a show where we will provide you fresh insights into South Asia's geopolitical, strategic and security situation. Let's take a look at the headlines first. Killer of Indian death row prisoner Sarabjit Singh shot dead in Pakistan's Lahore. Afghanistan's first female Olympian calls for ban over Taliban's rights record. And security forces neutralized elite terrorist in Jammu and Kashmir's Pulwama district. A Pakistani underworld don, Amir Sarfaraz, who killed Indian national Sarabjit Singh in jail, was assassinated by two motorcycle-borne assailants in the Slampura area of Lahore. Sarabjit Singh was lodged in, quote, Lakhpat jail. He died in the year 2013 after he was attacked by bricks, sharp metal sheets, iron rods and blades. Sarfaraz, who had close connection with LET founder Hafiz Saeed, was said to be behind the attack on the directions of Pakistan's spy agency ISI. Our report will give you the details.
On April 14, two unknown gunmen assassinated Indian death row prisoner Sarabjit Singh killer Amir Sarfaraz in Lahore, Pakistan. Amir Sarfaraz Tamba, known as the real Don of Lahore, had a dark history intertwined with violence and criminal activity. He was a close associate of Lashkar-e-Taiba founder Hafiz Saeed, a group infamous for the 2611 Mumbai attacks in India. Tamba was among those accused of brutally assaulting Sarabjit Singh in jail, an incident that resulted in Singh's tragic death in 2013. Upon hearing news of Tamba's killing, Swapandeep Kaur, Sarabjit Singh's daughter, expressed a mix of satisfaction and suspicion, alleging a possible conspiracy involving the Pakistani government behind Tamba's death, emphasizing her belief that true justice was yet to be served.
जिन्होंने पापा पे उस टाइम पे हमला करके उनको बुरी तरह से घायल कर दिया था जेल में, उसके बाद उनकी वहाँ पर मौत हो गई थी पाकिस्तान की जेल में ही. उनमें से एक जो शख्स था उसको कल गोलियों से मार के उसकी हत्या की गई है, कुछ मीर सरफराज, जिसपे मैं यही कहना चाहती हूँ कि जैसे हम कहते हैं कि कर्मों का फल यहीं पर ही मिलता है, ये उसके कर्मों का ही फल है. लेकिन इसके साथ ही मुझे लगता है एक बहुत बड़ी साजिश भी है ये पाकिस्तान की ही सरकार की तरफ से, क्योंकि ऐसे हो सकता है बहुत सारे राज हों जो उनको लगता हो कि बाहर ना आ जाएं दुनिया के सामने, क्योंकि ये भी एक पाकिस्तान सरकार की और वहाँ की एजेंसियों की ही एक मिलीभुगत के जो है कारण इन्होंने एक साजिश रच के ही मेरे पापा का वहाँ जेल में कत्ल करवाया था.
Sarabjit Singh was a poor Indian farmer hailing from Bikhiwind, a town in Punjab's Tarn Taran district. His story paints a tragic picture of misunderstanding and injustice. Singh unknowingly crossed into Pakistan in an inebriated state in 1990. Initially missing for 9 months, Sarabjit was suddenly arrested following a bomb blast in Pakistan that killed 14 Pakistani citizens. Moreover, he was not accused as Sarabjit Singh, but as Manjeet Singh. The Pakistan authorities captured Sarabjit and accused him of being a spy on a terror mission from India. His case went through several legal proceedings over the years, with appeals made by his family and supporters for his release or clemency. Despite international appeals for his release and clemency, including efforts from the Indian government and human rights organizations, Sarabjit's legal battle in Pakistan culminated in a death sentence in 1991, a decision repeatedly postponed but never overturned. Throughout his incarceration in Lahore's Kot Lakhpat jail, Sarabjit faced severe torture and a constant struggle to prove his innocence. Then, in 2013, a brutal attack by fellow inmates, including Amir Sarfaraz, left Sarabjit Singh in a coma. Singh's daughter believes this attack was orchestrated by collusion between Pakistani authorities and inmates, which ultimately led to his death.
बहुत सारे प्रयास किए गए थे जब पापा जेल में थे और जब उनकी मृत्यु भी हुई उसके बाद भी हमने बहुत कोशिश की थी कि इसको इंटरनेशनल लेवल पे उठाया जाए कि उनकी हत्या आखिरकार कैसे की गई, जैसे कि जबकि वो एक हाई सिक्योरिटी जेल के अंदर थे, एक सॉलिटरी कन्फाइनमेंट में, ऐसी जगह पे जाना किसी आम कैदी जो बाकी वहां पर रह रहे थे उनके बस की बात नहीं थी बिना के अथॉरिटीज के वहां मिली भगत।
द किलिंग ऑफ सरबजीत सिंह, अ विक्टिम ऑफ मिस्टेकन आइडेंटिटी, ignited widespread outrage in India, with many believing that he was targeted because of his Indian nationality and the contentious relationship between India and Pakistan. Here, he was seen as a victim of a flawed system, not a spy. Now, the man accused of playing a part in that tragedy is dead himself, gunned down by unknown assailants in Lahore.
Terrorism, a global menace, disrupts peace and stability worldwide. India, a victim of terrorism originating from Pakistan, consistently opposes terrorism and extremism. Despite facing challenges, New Delhi remains steadfast in its commitment to promoting peace and combating terrorism. Recently, India's External Affairs Minister S. Jaishankar reaffirmed India's strong stance against cross-border terrorism, which originates from Pakistan. We have a report.
Since its formation in 1947, Pakistan has persistently engaged in cross-border terrorism, with India bearing the brunt of these attacks. This pattern includes notorious incidents such as the 2001 assault on the Indian Parliament, the 2005 Delhi bombings, the 2008 Mumbai terror attack, as well as assaults on the Pathankot Air Base and the army camp in Uri, all linked to Pakistan-backed terrorism.
With regard to the
India has consistently condemned Pakistan's sponsorship of terrorism on global platforms. At a recent event in Pune, India's External Affairs Minister S. Jaishankar reiterated India's strong stance against cross-border terrorism originating from Pakistan. He emphasized that there can be no leniency towards terrorists.
एक चेंज है मुझे टेररिज्म पर चेंज कि अगर आप मुंबई के बाद आप में से एक भी व्यक्ति आप एक आई वुड लाइक टू सी वन पर्सन हु फील्स दैट वी शुड नॉट हैव रिस्पॉन्डेड टू मुंबई एवरीबडी इन द कंट्री फेल्ट इट बट येट अगर आप उस समय इसका एक अकाउंट है उस समय के बाद में एनएसए ने लिखा था उस समय के एनएसए नहीं अगले एनएसए जो यूपीए के एनएसए थे उन्होंने कहा कि दिस मिनिस्टर लुक्ड एट इट दैट मिनिस्टर लुक्ड एट इट सब लोग मिले बहुत एनालाइज किया वो प्लस माइनस देखा फिर हमने डिसाइड किया दैट द कॉस्ट ऑफ अटैकिंग पाकिस्तान इज मोर देन द कॉस्ट ऑफ नॉट अटैकिंग पाकिस्तान तो बहुत मंथन किया और कुछ नहीं निकला उसके बाद तो पॉइंट इज समथिंग लाइक मुंबई हैपेंस and if you do not react to it how can you prevent the next one from happening and unko ye nahi lagna chahiye ki bhai hum is line ke us paar hain to koi hame chhuega nahi see terrorists do not play by any rules the answer to terrorists cannot have any rules
Jaishankar's statements come in the wake of Guardian reports alleging India's involvement in the assassination of at least 20 individuals in Pakistan since 2020, part of a strategy to eliminate terrorists residing on foreign soil. India's Ministry of External Affairs has refuted these allegations, labeling them as false propaganda. Furthermore, Jaishankar highlighted that India's foreign policy has evolved since 2014. The minister also criticized Pakistan's persistent involvement in terrorism since 1947. He pointed out that clear condemnation and action against Pakistan's terrorist activities would have shaped India's policies differently.
Let us be honest, because all of us know. One very, very difficult one is Pakistan. And I would say isme we should actually ourselves look why is this? Because one reason for this is us. If we had from the very start been clear that Pakistan is using terrorism and ye hame bardasht kisi bhi halat mein bardasht nahi karna chahiye, we would have had a very different policy, not now. ये प्रॉब्लम जो है 2014 में शुरू नहीं हुई थी. मुंबई अटैक हुआ था तब भी नहीं हुई थी. ये हुई थी 1947 में. 1947 में द फर्स्ट पीपल जो पाकिस्तान से आए कश्मीर में आए, कश्मीर को अटैक किया, वो टेररिज्म था. वो शहरों को गांवों को जला रहे थे. वो दे वर जस्ट किलिंग पीपल ऑन लार्ज स्केल. एंड दीज वर पीपल जो ट्राइबल लोग जो हैं पाकिस्तान के नॉर्थ वेस्ट फ्रंटियर प्रोविंस से, उनको पाकिस्तानी आर्मी ने आगे किया और कहा कि आप लोग जाइए फर्स्ट टोटली डिस्टर्ब कश्मीर, उसके बाद हम लोग आपके पीछे आएंगे.
Notably, leaders of terrorist groups like Hafiz Saeed and Masood Azhar, operating from Pakistan, remain wanted by India, showcasing Pakistan's failure to act decisively against them. In response, India has taken various measures, including military actions against terrorists and enhancing border defenses. Despite these challenges, India's security forces have made strides in dismantling terrorist camps in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. However, the resolution of this issue ultimately rests on Pakistan's cessation of support for terrorist groups and the prevention of its territory from being used for terrorism against India.
Let's now turn our attention to Afghanistan, where the first woman to represent the country at the Olympics, Friba Rezai, has a brief and tenacious journey from athlete to activist. Recently, she has gained infamy for her criticism of the Taliban's treatment of women and her support of keeping Afghanistan out of the Paris Olympics. She has urged the International Olympic Committee, IOC, to take the stand against the mistreatment that the other women in her country endure. We have this report.
You can't hide behind one person under one flag.
Friba Rezai, the first woman to represent Afghanistan at the Olympics, condemns the treatment of women under the Taliban's resurgence. She is now advocating for Afghanistan's exclusion from the Paris Games. As the first woman to represent Afghanistan at the Olympics in 2004, she now calls on the International Olympic Committee to ban Afghanistan due to the Taliban's appalling human rights record. Residing in Vancouver, Canada since 2011, Riazi has founded Women's Leader of Tomorrow, a non-profit offering scholarships and educational programs for Afghan women, including athletes. Despite facing threats for her activism, she remains resolute in her mission to protect Afghan women's rights.
Given the facts and tons of evidence about the Taliban, about their human rights and brutal treatment of women and children and youth, they are very, very dangerous. If the IOC allows them to enter the Olympics at the heart of Europe in Paris in the year of 2024, it's very dangerous for the people of Europe. And it's also the IOC will set a precedent that being a terrorist group is okay. You can violate, you can stone people to death, but you can still participate at the Olympics.
The spokesperson for the Taliban administration, Zabihullah Mujahid, has declined to comment on the matter. Despite the Taliban's claims of respecting women's rights, whether their interpretation of Islamic law their actions paint a starkly different picture. The group has closed girls' high schools and imposed severe restrictions on women, including travel limitations without a male guardian and bans from parks and gyms. Reflecting on her historic participation in Athens, Riazi believed her presence would advance women's rights. However, her hopes were dashed following the Taliban's ascent to power in August 2021, which she claims undermined her efforts and those of the global community tolerant of the regime.
To me, it feels like whatever I did to support women's rights, gender equality, women's rights to support back in 2004, it is all undone by the IOC and by the Taliban and people who tolerate the Taliban.
The IOC previously suspended Afghanistan's National Olympic Committee in 1999, leading to the country's exclusion from the 2000 Sydney Games. Reinstated after the fall of the Taliban, Afghanistan's participation in the Olympics now hangs in the balance as human rights violations persist under Taliban rule. Riazi's plea to the IOC underscores the urgency of addressing human rights concerns on the global stage, especially within the context of major international events like the Olympics.
In Jammu and Kashmir, terrorists supported by Pakistan are attempting to destabilize the peace and create chaos in the Union Territory. However, the security forces in Jammu and Kashmir are operating at a heightened state of readiness, diligently working to dismantle the terrorist network within the region. In a recent operation, the Jammu and Kashmir police, in cooperation with security forces, successfully eliminated a Lashkar terrorist in Pulwama district, South Kashmir. Police records affirm the involvement of the slain terrorist in various terrorism-related offences.
On the 11th of April, a fierce confrontation unfolded between security forces and terrorists in the district of Pulwama in Jammu and Kashmir. This skirmish was instigated following the receipt of intelligence reports indicating the presence of terrorists in the vicinity. Swiftly, the security forces launched a cordon and search operation in Fresipura village in the Rajpura area of the South Kashmir district. During the search operation, as the joint search party approached towards the suspected spot, the hiding terrorists fired indiscriminately upon the joint search party, which retaliated effectively, leading to an encounter. In the ensuing encounter, a Lashkar-e-Taiba terrorist was killed. He has been identified as Danish Sheikh, a resident of Srinagar. Police also recovered arms, ammunition, and incriminating materials from the site of the encounter.
The Indian security forces have embarked on a three-pronged program to tackle this menace. First is the use of technology, including cyber surveillance. The second is extensive use of drones in intelligence collection and in assisting of operations on ground. And lastly, is the giving of latest weapons and equipment to the Indian security forces who are deployed in Jammu and Kashmir. Few days back, on 11th April, a dreaded Lashkar-e-Taiba terrorist, Danish Sheikh, was killed by the Indian security forces in Fresipura village in Pulwama district of Jammu and Kashmir. This successful operation by the Indian security forces yet again show the professional competence and the immense ability of our men in uniform to thwart any attempt which can be detrimental to the safety and security of India.
A large number of terrorists with backing from Pakistan remain concealed within Jammu and Kashmir, persistently seeking opportunities to execute acts of terror and disrupt the peace within the region. Yet, despite the nefarious intentions harbored by Pakistan-based terrorists, counter-terrorism operations have exhibited remarkable success in quelling the menace within Jammu and Kashmir. In the month of January this year, a Lashkar-e-Taiba terrorist who was involved in the killing of an army personnel and non-local laborers killed in an encounter with security forces in Jammu and Kashmir's Shopian district. Many experts opine that these operations have left anti-social elements in the region feeling powerless, as heightened scrutiny is applied to their logistical and financial support networks. Pakistan's persistent endeavors to disrupt the peace in India is not a new phenomenon.
Till Pakistan will exist as a nation, it will continue to support terrorism in Jammu and Kashmir. Hence, to counter this Pakistani threat, we need to take three steps. One, keep on increasing our military deterrence and capabilities. Second, the indoctrination of Kashmiri youth happening in some madrasas need to be curtailed and ensure that the madrasas impart modern education. And lastly, the justice system in our country has to be swift within a specific time frame.
In response to these unrelenting attempts, India has meticulously implemented a comprehensive framework designed to thwart individuals dispatched and supported by Pakistan. This multifaceted approach involves the Border Security Force intercepting drones engaged in the illicit transport of drugs and ammunition on Indian soil, while the National Investigation Agency conducts targeted raids to disrupt the financial networks supporting terrorists within India. Furthermore, India's deeply entrenched intelligence network plays a pivotal role by supplying crucial information that informs ground-level counter-terrorism operations conducted by the police and the army, thereby ensuring the preservation of peace in the Union Territory despite Pakistan's recurrent malevolent endeavors.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We'll be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Shivangi Mishra signing off on behalf of the entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.